Hi, I'm Mamta. Today we are continuing chapter 3, the last concept of the chapter, which is dealing with what are the factors that promote positive health and well-being. Now, according to WHO research, they basically try and propagate not just handling stress or not just trying to understand how it can be managed, but also it says how it can be prevented. So that health concept, when we talk about health per se, we are not just dealing with trying to manage the health related issues, but also trying to understand how we can be well, having our well-being intact, how we can be preventing certain health related issues by managing different kinds of stress. Now, here we are trying to understand different health promoting behaviors, under which we have one major concept known as the stress resistant personality. Now, it's very interesting to know that a lot of people, although are having high degree of stress, but they are able to manage themselves really well because of the kind of personality that they have. A lot of people who are having type A personality face the maximum level of stress, and they are suffering from major illnesses also quite early in their lives. Although type A personality is one part of it, the other part is a stress resistant personality. Now, such people, according to the Kobasa's study, basically understand what are the aspects that make a person very, very resistant or very, very resilient to coping and dealing with stress. So, even if they are faced with a lot of tough and challenging situations, they are still strong enough and they bounce back with their inner strength and capability. So, Kobasa tried to understand what are those qualities. He understood three C's of personality, these three characteristics which are known as hardiness. So, such people are emotionally and psychologically very strong, resistant and very, very hard in terms of dealing with situations outside. These three C's are commitment, control and challenge. Commitment to work, to pleasure, to hobbies, to family, all these commitments ensure that you are constantly going on and working with things. Even if you face stress, you are standing and facing it. That is commitment. Second is control. If you think you can control a certain situation, the situation is under your control. It is your perception that you think so and therefore you can control. Such people are very, very strong, very, very resistant. So, even if they have been facing one situation after the other, which has been testing their strength, they will still coming out successful. And with that, next time onwards, they will face it with even more resilience. Third is challenge. Now, a lot of us will take the same situation for an opportunity. For instance, somebody getting promoted. And getting promoted means the person has to travel to another place. Now, if that person takes it as a challenge, he will take it as an opportunity to grow in his profession. Alternatively, somebody might feel that this will make me away from my family. But then, challenges how you are able to manage both the fronts and still be happy. So, the higher the happier quotient, the lower will be the stress. The higher the hardiness, the lower will be the stress. That's a stress resistant personality. Second concept that we have, and a major one at that, is known as life skills. Life skills as such, the name suggests, deals with what are the qualities that you have imbibed in yourself over a period of time to deal with your life. Okay, let's understand what are the different kind of life skills that we have to cover. First is known as assertiveness. Assertiveness as such means trying to express yourself without feeling conscious, without thinking what will others say, and assessment of the situation and saying no to it. Now, a lot of times when suppose your friends tell you to accompany them to a party or a disc, your parents may not be very comfortable with the idea. So, in this situation, what do you do? Do you go with your friends because you're not able to say no to them? Because you feel, what will they think? They will isolate me. They are my friends and they would want me to be there with them. Otherwise, they will say, I don't have the courage to take that challenge. It could be a aspect of trying out drugs for the first time, which is a very negative aspect. But because you are under pressure and you're not able to say no, you are basically going into it because your friends want you to. So this is what assertiveness is, that whatever you think is right, you are able to do that without succumbing to any kind of pressure. That is your confidence level. That is what you think about yourself. If you are sure about what you want in your life, you will not succumb to any kind of pressure, no matter what, because you are very clear about what you want and what are your priorities. So you would not give in to what your friends expect you to do. Similar thing happens in a workplace also, and in different situations of life. If you can say no to somebody without getting bothered by your identity or feeling low in confidence or thinking what the other person is going to think about you, then you are an assertive person. So if I'm able to express myself without the fear, if I'm able to express my opinion without getting conscious, that is assertiveness, which is a very positive social skill. We move on to the second point, which is known as rational thinking. Rational thinking, as the name itself suggests, we are thinking positively. A lot of times in a particular situation, we only select a particular situation which is negative, think about it, and we feel like a failure. So if a child has not got good marks in a particular subject, he starts thinking, I'm good for nothing, I can't study, I'm not even capable of scoring well, and I'm a failure. Now, all these thoughts are irrational thoughts, because how can one mark decide, one subject's mark decide that you're a failure in life? So that is what is rational or irrational thinking, where you are using logic, where you are thinking from a larger perspective and not just limiting yourself to a selected situation and distorting reality. So you are looking at the complete reality and not selecting one part of the reality which is negative and thinking or making assumptions about yourself. That is a big life skill known as rational thinking. Third we have is improving relationships. Now here, most of the relationship that we have are either one-way track, either you're only listening or you're only expressing yourself. So relationship ideally need a lot of components to be healthy. One is to be a good listener, which is a very beautiful aspect, but a very less used aspect in relationships. Most people just want to share what they have in their heart and do not have the patience to listen. So that is where relationships are falling apart nowadays. Now, this is the concept of listening, when you're actually taking interest through your body language and through your gestures and through your responses into what the other people are telling you. You are accepting people as they are and not always wanting to change them, not always judging them, not always passing remarks according to your state of mind. Because what I want the other person to be, the person may not want to be like that. So that is the way I am controlling the other person using my power, trying to change the person to fit in that person into my frame of mind the way I like it. But that's not how the person is. The person is a very unique being, therefore has a right to be himself. So I need to accept that person the way the person is, without any colored lenses or any judgments being passed. That is about relationships. Then we have the concept of self-care. Self-care is when we are taking care of our own selves, we are giving time to our own selves, we are doing a lot of exercise, and we are doing breathing properly. Now, a lot of people, when they breathe in, if you compare it with a child, an infant will expand the stomach and breathe in completely and contract the stomach and breathe out. A normal individual who is stressed out will do the opposite way. Check for yourself to understand where you're falling. If it is the opposite, change it consciously so that you can take care of yourself. Positive thoughts again help you take care of yourself. A proper diet, a nutritious diet, and not a junk food or a comfort food, it is again very, very important. Okay, let's move on to the last topic of the chapter, which is maintaining positive health. What are the steps that we can take to maintain positive health? First is diet. Now, for being healthy, the first prerequisite is that you need to take care of what you eat, because what you eat gives you energy. Now, if you eat something that is hollow in energy or nutrients, you are going to feel very, very weak, and you are going to take in a lot of negativity in yourself. That is why, you know, even people say that you should not go out and eat, because wherever you go out somewhere, the person who is cooking with the mindset of earning a lot. So with that thought, when you get in and when you eat that particular food with that thought, your body doesn't get the right energy. That is why it is said that when somebody goes on to cook, they should go with a very pure and a positive thought. They should go relaxed. So imagine your mother starting to cook after a fight. Those thoughts will get into your food and you will get the same kind of energy. And also taking in comfort foods and junk foods like chocolates, which give a quick high but ultimately harm the health, should be avoided. As much as fruits can be taken, as much as light foods can be taken, and also maintaining the aspect of a healthy breakfast and a low dinner and an early dinner before 7 also help. Now, normally people take a very light breakfast or do not take breakfast at all, but that just fluctuates the sugar level in the body, because when we take dinner, after that there are a number of hours, a lot of gap before our next meal of breakfast. So imagine, children, when you do not take breakfast, what happens to you in the assembly? You start feeling low, you start fainting. So breakfast has to be good and good quality, as well as with full of nutrients and health. We move on to the second concept, which is exercise. Now, exercise, again, any form of exercise you do, jogging, swimming, aerobics, yoga, any kind of exercise does help you maintain yourself, your energy level, your fitness, you being fit and fine, healthy, as well as slim. So it burns down the fat, it rejuvenates your mind, gives you the energy. So exercise gives you what is known as positive fatigue. You might feel a little tired after exercise, but that's positive energy that you get after doing exercise. So try and take out that much time for yourself every day so that you can do some form of exercise. If you like to play, that's even a great exercise. Please go ahead and do that. Okay, third concept that we have in maintaining positive health is known as positive attitude. Now, a lot of people, they have a habit of sulking over everything. Every time they get a situation, they are not able to accept and tolerate it. They criticize others. They are not happy at the way things are. That is a very negative attitude, which results in a lot of frustration and stress, which they themselves create, which really harms them. That is why a positive attitude really helps one deal a very healthy, mentally healthy life and be very happy. So obviously it's a vicious cycle where you are reducing your stress, you are happy, creating positive vibes, positive thoughts, and that results in positive health. So it's very good to consciously adopt a positive attitude. Then we have the concept of positive thinking. Now, you must have heard of the concept of the glass half full or the glass half empty, the concept of optimist versus pessimist. Optimists look at every possibility of good thing in a situation. Pessimists look at every positive situation also in a negative manner. Researchers have quoted that positive health is a basic determinant for people who think positive. They can deal with any situation very effectively and still be healthy. Last concept that we have is social support. Now, if somebody feels they have a lot of people they can share their thoughts with, they will feel so blessed, they will feel so happy and positive, so there'll be no stress at all. That's the perceived social support. What do I think if I have a problem? Whom can I bank upon? That's a perceived social support. One is social network. I may have so many people with me, but I may not have anybody close to me to help me out. Results have also stated that people have a very complicated pregnancy if they are not having a good social support system. Now, social support can be of three types. One is tangible social support, something concrete that you see. A child is helped by his friends through money, or a parent praises the child, or a reward. That is a tangible, what you see as a support. Second, we have the informational support. Suppose a child is absent from school on medical grounds, his friends provides him with all the notes. That is the informational social support, when you know that somebody will help you out. For an exam, a tutor is an informational social support. Then we have emotional support. Friends are a greatest emotional support. When I'm feeling upset, I can call up my friends and talk to them. When I'm not happy about something, I can share my thoughts. So I know I'm reassured, something is there to listen to me, to guide me, to protect me. With that, we wind up the chapter for today. We have tried to understand positive health and well-being. What are the factors which ensure it, maintain it, sustain it, and particularly the concept of exam stress, how it reduces our well-being when we take a lot of stress for every situation that we face in our life. That's all for today. Thank you.